Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to get started in a moment. Thanks to everybody for joining us on, are we on day 2.5 or 3 of SOCAP at 4 o'clock in the afternoon? It's not the easiest time to get engaged in a good conversation. but I think we have a really interesting panel today, so hopefully it's energizing. My name is Kate Danaher. I work at RSF Social Finance. We're a local Bay Area nonprofit financial services organization, and we have been around for just over 30 years. And we work to provide, sorry, I forgot that that was happening. That'll be an interesting challenge. So at RSF, what we've done over the past 30 years is we make loans to for-profits and nonprofit social enterprises that are creating positive social or environmental change in one of our three focus areas: sustainable food and agriculture, ecological stewardship, and education and the arts. So I'm really honored to be sitting here on a panel with three guys from three very cool companies that are trying to do a lot of the same thing with funds that they're taking out of their own company's profits and putting into interesting social enterprises. So to my left, this is Greg with White Road Investments from Clif Bar, Phil from Patagonia's 20 million in change fund, and Pete, who works with Seventh Generation's internal investment arm, I think is what we decided to call it. So I think that the way we're going to start is I'm going to kind of set the context for the conversation, give each of these guys about 5 minutes to introduce themselves, their companies, the funds, maybe give an example of one of the companies they've invested in that is that kind of demonstrates what their fund is trying to do. And then we're going to dive into what I think is going to be a pretty interesting conversation. So I don't usually use props on stage, but I wanted to start with, at RSF, we've spent a lot of time trying to define for ourselves what we believe a social enterprise is. And so I wanted to take a minute to read how we think of a social enterprise, because I think it'll really help inform the rest of the conversation. So at RSF, we define a social enterprise as a business or corporation in which the economic activity is a means towards creating significant social and/or ecological impact that has a public benefit. Often, social enterprises are formed to address a specific societal need, but also may be committed to leading change in the respective industry or sector. A social enterprise views its values as central to all aspects of its work and is committed to holding itself accountable in pursuit of its mission. Social enterprises are driven not only by what they can accomplish, but also how they accomplish it. Social enterprises practice transparency in all matters of governance, business practices, and financial and human sustainability. So we came up with that maybe 4 or 5 years ago. The term social enterprise hasn't been around for all that long. But I do think that there are a lot of companies out there that have been around for 20, 40 years even, that have grown up as social enterprises, whether they self-identified as that or not. And I think the three companies sitting on stage are some of the best examples of how values and integrity can really build a strong, profitable, and impactful organization. And then what they're trying to do with their funds is really try and proliferate the movement of social enterprises or like-minded organizations to change the way this world does business. So with that, I'd like to hand it over to you guys to take about 5 minutes each to introduce your organizations and your funds, and then we'll dive into conversation.
Do you want to know about me personally?
Sure. Okay. Tell me whatever you want. I will listen.
My name is Greg Bagney. My last real job was 14 years, 11 months, and 1 day ago. I'm not counting. But I was the Senior Vice President of Marketing and Product Development for Schwinn Cycling and Fitness. I was super lucky. I was standing in the right place at the right time. I was picked to be part of the management team. They were bankrupt. We picked them up out of Boulder, out of Chicago, moved into Boulder, rebuilt the company, brought them back to number one in the U.S. And when the private equity firm, the typical private equity firm, got ready to flip us for the third time in 7 years, I quietly left out the back door. Took some time off, became a consultant. We're different than consultants. We spread love. And I focus a lot on natural foods, outdoor, bike, ski areas, tour and travel, consumer brands, enthusiast brands. And I met Gary Erickson and Kit Crawford, the founders of Clif Bar. Oh, I met Gary in my office in 1995, and we hit it off, and we just kind of, it was love at first sight. And we stayed in touch, and I was on a crazy bike ride with Gary, I don't know, maybe 7 years ago in the Dolomites in Italy. And he said that they wanted to start this fund because when they were growing Clif Bar, they had no access to capital other than, you know, credit cards, angels, typical private equity. If typical private equity goes bad, you know, I mean, things can get very ugly. There's no such thing as a divorce. And he said, talk to your wife. And I said, I'm going to talk to her, but I'm in. And then it was about a year later, we were on another crazy bike ride in Northern California. He said, it was June, he said, we're going to start this thing in September. We ended up starting it in August, and that was 5 years ago in September. And we typically look for small mission-driven companies, somewhere between $1 million and $20 million in revenue. We like when they sort of mirror themselves after the aspirations or have a like-minded viewpoint of the aspirations of Clif Bar, where it's really all about the business and all about the brand and about people and product and community and the planet. And we now, I think, have 13 companies that we're invested in. We usually take a minority investment. We're different because if you say, hey, I'm in and out in 3 years, we'll listen to you, but at the same time, we're a little bit more patient. If you can do what you say you're going to do, we'll hang with you for a while. Especially if you're spreading the love and doing some good. So with that said, I think we have 7 or 8 natural foods, 2 in outdoor, 2 in bike. I mean this, I am personally the luckiest being on the planet to be doing what I'm doing right now. I'm a subcontractor. I started year one about 20% of my time, now it's about 80% of my time. And this job has raised my game. It's not radically different, but I act different now. I mean, there's a level of responsibility and, I think I'm a little bit more thoughtful now, a little less reactive, both in speech and mind and body. So with that said, that's a personal shout out to both Gary Erickson and Kit Crawford, because they dragged me along on this thing and introduced me to two of my colleagues, John Anthony and Devin Clemens, and Devin's the managing director, technically he's my boss, who I never met before. So it's been a wonderful ride and relationship, and we're all happy right now because we had our first 2 exits this year. And it wasn't really things we were planning, it just sort of happened. So,
Greg, can you really quickly, because I want everyone to get a flavor of the types of companies in your portfolio, can you talk about one of the exits really quickly or
yeah, sure.
the type
Real
of company
quick.
It
Manitoba
is?
Manitoba Harvest, plant-based protein based around hemp, industrial hemp. They make hemp hearts, which is an edible shelled hemp seed, and they also make hemp-based protein powders. And they exited this year in May, and then the other one was one we jumped into called Santa Cruz Bikes. They make mountain bikes, and they were acquired by a large Dutch-based bike conglomerate, and that happened back in May, June also.
Gotcha. Thank you.
So with that, those two said, I have a job for at least another year.
Well done. hi, everybody. My name is Phil Graves. I'm Director of Corporate Development for Patagonia. And my path is similar, so I did the consulting thing for a while. I started my career at Deloitte, where I advised companies on investments, mergers, acquisitions, scenarios, corporate finance type issues, and was getting close to partner, was in the pipeline with the next year or two, and realized like there's more to life than money. Like, do I want to do this forever and work long hours just to get a really good bonus at the end of the year? I've got 3 little girls, love the outdoors, love the environment, and it was a challenge to bring that into the work that I was doing, because as a consultant, you're very reactive. So if a client has a need, whether they're mission-driven or not mission-driven, you try to address it through whatever it is that you do. And came to that realization that I was going to look for something else and try to align with an organization that had the same values that I did. And Patagonia had been around a really long time, as Kate mentioned, always admired the brand and what we stand for. and was fortunate enough, and it's ironic because I viewed myself as the luckiest person on the planet too, with my role. Maybe we can like Farkle after the panel to see who really is. But I came to Patagonia a couple years ago, and with my role heading corporate dev there, I get to manage our $20 million and change venture fund. And the fund is not like a typical fund where it's a 7-year fund or a 10-year fund where we make investments, hopefully have a profitable exit. The North Star, whenever we make an investment, goes to our mission statement, which is a little bit shorter, but it's an extension of the third part of it, which is use business to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis. So I view the fund as that, taking these learnings that we've had for the last 40-plus years as a company and applying these to these other industry verticals that can have an environmental impact. Some of the nitty-gritty on our fund, like the mechanics, we also make minority-level investments very similar to White Road. We like to come in around a 2 to 20% ownership stake. If we invest in a company and it's just, if we do $1 million investment and they're going to raise $500 million in capital, we feel like that's probably not going to be a meaningful amount of capital to the company long-term. So even if they're doing great things for the environment, we generally will pass. And on the other side, if a company is just, again, with an idea, we don't want to make a controlling investment. So we don't require a seat on the board. We typically give the company the capital they need to do great things environmentally, and then provide assistance as needed, but it's less operational focused, which is maybe a little bit of a difference between the two. Mm-hmm. An investment that I'll highlight, and it's tough because like you view these, I'm sure you do too, both of you, as your kids, so it's like, how do you pick a favorite? Because you can't have a favorite kid, even though if anybody's a parent, you kind of have a favorite kid, you just can't state publicly. But the one I'll give a shout out to is Boreo. This company turns fishing nets into skateboard decks. And they collect fishing nets up and down the coast of Chile. It's these three friends. One was a consultant, common thing, a lot of consultants out there. But he's an environmental consultant and is working in Chile. Of course, Chile has a long coastline. And then these three buddies were surfers and were really passionate about the ocean and protecting the health of the ocean. And when you look at plastic pollution in the ocean, it's a major problem. And so what they determined was 10% of the plastic in the ocean is due to discarded fishing gear, fishing nets. And so what they did, they've established these collection ports up and down the coast of Chile, paid local Chileans to give the nets to them as opposed to dumping them in the ocean or hauling them to a landfill or burning them on the beach. Sometimes that was what was being done. And with those nets, they clean them, mechanically separate them, and turn them into a skateboard deck. And they've been real successful on the skateboards. They also just launched a Kickstarter that hit their goal 6 times over and launched sunglasses. So the sunglasses I've got here are the Boreo shades, and the plastic is the nylon that was formerly the fishing, nice. Fishing net. So really cool example of a company that their business model is profitable, like any other sunglass company. They do it and make money on it, but it solves an environmental problem through that business.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Cool.
Thank you.
Nice.
Pete.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Pete Albersi from Seventh Generation. And our approach is a little bit different. For example, our ventures effort is a part-time job of mine. I get to do anything that has anything to do with customers worldwide with Seventh Generation. So anything with sales capabilities, customer service even, is one of my responsibilities. And then I have the pleasure of being general manager of Seventh Generation Ventures. And you have to go back 27 years to understand Seventh Generation. And the company was named for a specific reason. And Seventh Generation is taken from really the Iroquois nation, the confederacy of the Iroquois tribes, had a saying that said, in every deliberation, we must, you know, judge the impact on our decision on the next seventh generation. So Seventh Generation was set up 27 years ago to think differently, to think long-term, to think about more than just the company. In fact, it was a mission without a business for many years, in fact, struggling to raise capital on its own. And in the last several years, we've been able to turn that business around. We've put over $100 million of growth on in the last couple of years in terms of sales. And how do we then position ourselves in a spot that we can therefore lift other companies up? So a lot of the capabilities we have as a company are to take good, solid businesses. And this really comes out of a lot of coaching we've done with up-and-coming businesses in the health and wellness space. We're good at taking those smaller businesses and making them much stronger. And we think our effort is really about inviting some of these businesses to join the seventh generation effort. And one of our big efforts is to transform commerce. And we believe that the companies of the last 100 years really need to be doing things differently. So it's a long-term perspective versus a short-term perspective. It's a how do we invest for top-line growth versus manage for quarterly earnings. It's full transparency versus hiding behind a veil. And it's also really about authentic brands that mean something versus brands that are created and targeted at a specific market. Mm-hmm. So to us, it's about top-line growth. And as I said, one of our key tenets is to transform business and transform commerce. The bigger and stronger we are, the more good we can do. And that's one of the key things that we're looking to do. So it's more of an acquisition type position. We would love for entrepreneurs to be part of something much bigger together. And we can bring a lot of capabilities to bear to help them achieve their original vision and be part of something and be an equity holder in long-term growth going forward. And so one of the companies that we invested in and then ended up acquiring early on was a water bottle company named Bobble. It's a bottle that filters as you drink. And there's an intense hatred for single-use plastic bottles. It's a good thing there isn't one near Kate right now. But, you know, right now we use about 52 billion bottles in North America a year. That's over a billion bottles a week. Single-use bottles, they end up in sunglasses now, which is a good thing. But the waste is really ridiculous. So how do we think about solving that solution in a smart and stylish way? So you're going to see this brand we acquired a couple years ago completely relaunched in a couple of months with all new products. And we think we want to do better in that particular business by giving people a smart and stylish solution and not just wagging your finger and saying you shouldn't do that. So how do we provide something better and different and move forward in that way and be all stronger together?
Thanks. Apparently, it's not enough to shame me backstage about my single-use water bottle.
And then you brought it out here.
I did. That was so there's a theme that I just want to call out. I think one of the first conversations I ever had with Phil, we were talking about what he does, and he's like, I have the coolest job in the world. And I was like, wait, I have the coolest job in the world. And I think in our conversation last week, you're like, no, I've got the coolest job in the world. So. Sure. I think we should just take a moment to recognize how lucky we all are to work in this space. So I want to open this up more for conversation, and my goal is to end with about 20 minutes for questions. So we've got about 20 minutes to have the conversation, but I guess I wanted to start with why you? Why are you guys uniquely positioned to make these investments and create the change you want to see in the world? What is it that you bring to the party? And I want to set it in the context of, we're all here talking about social capital markets. In the world where a lot of the change innovation is happening, which is in food and consumer products, there is a tremendous amount of money out there right now to acquire brands. Valuations are off the charts. And it's a really interesting time. And so I'm really interested in, beyond the money, what is it that an investor can bring to the party? So. And I'd love for you guys don't have to go in order. I think it'd be interesting to have a conversation around it. Whoever wants to start.
Well, I'll go first. So two things came to mind when you mentioned that, like why Patagonia? Why do we even have an investment fund in the first place? So back to the initial point, Patagonia has been around for over 40 years, and obviously we do outdoor apparel. We have a food startup that we launched here in Sausalito called Patagonia Provisions. But we've learned a lot across the last 40 plus years on responsible things, environmental best practices that aren't limited to making a jacket or making a pouch of salmon for Patagonia Provisions. Mm-hmm. And given the environmental crisis that we're in, we thought establishing a fund that is truly unique and not like a typical VC or private equity shop that's out there could be a mechanism to hit on these key areas, which for our fund, it's food, water, energy, waste, and apparel. And we thought we can invest, we can, with our unique structure. So again, not being a technical fund, we're the investment arm, you know, much like PETA is for Patagonia, we can take the long-term position. So we're not raising outside capital. Patagonia is closely held. The Chouinards are the only shareholders at this point. And Yvonne has told me many times, like, I have enough money. So, like, it's so refreshing as an investor to look at it from a 10-year perspective, from a 50-year perspective, and say, like, I don't have to report quarterly what the earnings have been for the investments or what our valuation of the portfolio is. I mean, I track that because I'm an investment guy and that matters. And if we want to make a meaningful change that scales that other investment shops will implement, you've got to look holistically at it. Mm-hmm. And so to have that long-term view, to be able to identify entrepreneurs and say, hey, we're not even going to take a seat on the board. We're going to spend a lot of time vetting you. And are you really all about this mission? Are you trying to make a quick buck and get sold to a strategic guy or have an IPO in the next 2 years? But are you in it for the long haul? We closely examine supply chain. So we do spend a ton of time on diligence, especially environmental due diligence and social due diligence. How are the workers treated? What chemicals are used in whatever it is that you're making? We have an army of in-house environmental types that I can pull into each investment we look at. So it's to have that long-term view and to offer a unique perspective in terms of connections we can make and focus on the environmental and the social aspect in addition to the financial things that will enable them to be successful.
Why don't you guys take a board seat? I imagine a lot of your ventures would be like, please sit on my board.
Right. And that has happened, and we've said yes before.
Yeah.
We don't require it. So one is bandwidth. So we've made 10 investments to date.
You've made 10 investments over
the last couple of years, right, yeah. Exactly. And the team is really small. And so there's a lot of really cool things that happen at board meetings, and some things, again, like our mission is to keep them to their mission on the environmental side. So one of the things that we do to protect that is include environmental covenants. So if a company takes a wrong turn from the environment, uses a harmful chemical, these Boreo guys, if they wanted to use virgin nylon in the sunglasses, that would be what I would consider as a wrong turn from the environment. So we protect ourselves and keep the mission in the line that way. But we don't necessarily step in and say, hey, this is how you should operate the business, bring in a new chief marketing officer. The one caveat to that I will say that we will do is we're going to have a summit this year where we bring together these 10 portfolio companies and share best practices. So we'll have our COO, our CEO, all our execs there that are going to be available, have Q&A, talk about things like packaging or transportation and like common issues that we all face, whether you're making jackets or a food product or you're an energy company, and share those best practices. So that's kind of our view of a board meeting, if you will, is these summits or symposiums, whatever you call it, where we bring everybody together and talk through some of the issues that we're facing collectively.
Cool.
I think what's interesting about what we do is we're operators. We're sort of atypical private equity. All of us have had real jobs before. All of us have had successes and failures before. And with that said, that experience can be powerful. I'm more of a market, product, developer, brand person. That's what I did before. Devin Clemens, our managing director, is a finance and ops expert. John Anthony is a sales and distribution god in the natural foods business. We also have Jen Cao, who's internal from Clif Bar, who helps us on the finance side also. She's fantastic. So with that said, we really can kind of cover all the bases with an emerging brand. And I think the other piece of it is, whether there's financial capital and intellectual or creative capital, we really pride ourselves on our connective capital. So like Phil, it's great to have a mothership. So that connective capital is everything from, hey, you need a good broker on the East Coast, call my friend Lenny, or to, hey, I need creative help, or we need ops help, or whatever the case may be. We have a really, really good connective capital resource that we can tap into, both that we have personally and with Cliff and all the companies around us. So it makes a really big difference. We like board seats. We'll take one, but we're like you. We don't need one. But it's always great to sort of be in the room because we try and bring that value add to the party.
Yeah, I would add a lot of similarities from my counterparts here. The big key that differentiates what we're trying to do, and we've been developing a lot of relationships with company founders and entrepreneurs for years, do a lot of coaching. the big difference between what we're trying to do and maybe a private equity raise is that we're in this for the long term and we're in it for top line growth. So how do we help this company grow significantly to serve the mission that it was founded to do? And how do we help that founder's vision become reality? And I think that's really an important piece where we're more than willing to invest, you know, virtually all the EBITDA back into growth. We're certainly a for-profit business, but we're a privately held business. All our employees are shareholders. We're all in this to change how commerce is done. We're not here to position it to be flipped again in 3 to 5 years or 7 years on a multiple of EBITDA. So people really appreciate that particular perspective, and then there's the capable capital piece that you guys talked about in terms of 27 years, we've been building a lot of capabilities that any company that is up and coming, say $20 million in sales, et cetera, if they're gonna wanna do business with Whole Foods and Target and international distributors, serve the new millennium consumer that we know well, how are they gonna build all those tools and resources? We've already built a lot of that. How do we leverage that better and accelerate that particular company? An example would be R&D. You know, we've got a floor full of scientists who are working on packaging as an example. How do you have 100% PCR packaging? So, you know, we're not using any virgin materials to make packaging. We have scientists who are working on formulas. How do we have completely bio-based formulas that don't use petroleum products? How do we help companies, and we help companies that we're not even involved with financially, formulate their products better to serve the consumer, but also serve the earth and nurture nature, which is one of our other tenets. So it goes all throughout supply chain. You know, we have 21 manufacturing locations. We have 6 distribution centers in the United States alone. Why not put more through those particular pipes? Marketing, sales, direct to consumer, and we do business with every significant retailer, frankly, in most of the developed world, particularly in North America. So that gives a few good reasons why it makes a lot of sense. And again, the whole point is we can be much stronger together if we create what I call, with a bit of tongue-in-cheek, a parallel universe to the Procter & Gambles and the Kimberly-Clarks. You know, we're really tired of companies that do the minimum to get by in terms of regulatory issues or human health issues. We want to go that extra step. We want to be totally transparent. You know, we're the first company years ago that put every ingredient on the back of a bottle of laundry detergent. You know, people thought we were crazy. Why would you do that? Because everyone else wants to hide their formulas, wants to hide what's in them. We think the new way to do this for the next 7 generation will win, because that new millennium shopper cares about these things much more than the previous generations did.
Thanks. So my next question is around, so when investors invest equity, they're generally looking for some kind of exit, which in a lot of cases requires fast growth, scaling, selling, acquisition, and we see a lot of that in our space. And I'm wondering how you guys, since you all, you know, some people don't take a minority, you know, you don't take a majority share, you don't take seats on boards, you really partner for long-term growth. How do you guys have the conversation with your companies around their growth trajectory and their exits, and how do you address the liquidity issue?
I'll start on that one. You know, it's funny, we're called White Road Investments because if you haven't read Gary Erickson's books, Raising the Bar, I would suggest doing that. It's a great read, but you know, if you go to a Michelin map, all the big superhighways are red, the medium roads are yellow, and all the small little cool back roads are white. And those are the best traveled, coolest, most rewarding, a little bit harder, a little bit more adventurous, mm-hmm. And that's the way we approach that. So most of the time, we're very direct. We say, hey, what do you want to do when you grow up? And I mean, what's going to happen in 5 years? Do you want to do this for the next 10 years? Are you 3 in and 3 out? I mean, so we have very open conversations up front with our founders and the principals of the business to say, what is it exactly you want to do with this thing? Mm-hmm. Most of the time, they have a pretty good idea. Sometimes they don't. You know, I mean, so we kind of roll with them along the way, but to both these gentlemen's theory, you know, we're not in a big hurry, but at the same time, we still love to see forward progress. We love to see them, you know, make a positive impact on the things that they're doing.
Mm-hmm. I would add, we are the exit for many founders who want a really great place to see their brands and their companies and their employees flourish going forward. So, you know, we're in conversation with a company now that the founders are looking to retire and slow down a little bit. So how do we look at a four-year time period where, you know, the business continues to grow where it is? We can invest in it. We can lend a lot of our capabilities, a lot of connections from a broker on the East Coast to a place to manufacture product. How do we improve things? How do we market to the new millennial mom as an example? There's lots of opportunities for us to shepherd a brand further, and there's nothing more rewarding to a founder than to look back 10 or 12 years and say, wow, look what my baby's become to some degree, and it's in the hands of the right kind of people who aren't just looking to, you know, flip it for a bigger multiple down the road. So we actually don't have an issue, thank goodness, with the liquidity issue. We have a deep enough bench of investors in our company that every 18 months to 2 years, we'll do a liquidity event. So if somebody wants to sell their shares privately back to existing or new investors, then we're certainly able to do that today. So it kind of is a self-feeding system, which is a beautiful thing. I should also mention that our second largest shareholder base is our employees, which is really cool. So every new employee is an equity holder in the business, and also creates a lot of alignment for the long-term perspective that we do have.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
Wait for
Here they
it.
Come.
Yeah. Oh. I'm sponsored by the Blue Angels. I'm sorry I brought them along today.
You're going to fly off home.
That's right. Yeah. Waiting for a ride.
That's great. Very similar here from our perspective. We do the same things that Greg and White Road do. So we want to get our arms around why are the founders doing it? Are they doing it because green, eco-friendly is sexy right now, and that's where all the VC dollars come in, and that's what they're looking to do? Or are they really passionate about the product? Like on the Brayo example, they're passionate about getting these nets and the nylon out of the ocean to avoid the ocean plastic pollution. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have to be that sexy of a story. Like there's another company we invested in who recognizes the water crisis that we're in. So they have a liquid CO2-based platform that can clean and coat textiles. Mm-hmm. So they're passionate about the water side and not necessarily getting sold in a couple years. So mm-hmm. I mean, on one hand, we recognize that liquidity is important for the entrepreneurs, and it's going to happen. So maybe a company we invest in will go public, and that's okay. Maybe one will get sold, and that's okay. Hopefully it's to the right like-minded buyer, mm-hmm. if it's out there. But we're also okay if a company wants to stay private. Patagonia's done it. We've mm-hmm. been a private company for over 40 years. Patagonia pays dividends to the founder. So as an equity investor, we can receive dividends. So there doesn't have to be a liquidity event outside of dividends for us to be content with our investment.
Yeah. And something, Phil, that you said that, because I'm constantly thinking about, as companies scale, how they maintain the integrity of their brand and their values. And of course, coming into one of your portfolios, I think is number one, the best way is aligning the capital that you're bringing in with your values. But I'm wondering specifically, you said that you guys build covenants into your agreements and
right.
your documents to keep them at least, yeah, keep them on the road. How do you, Pete, you guys might not have to deal with that because you're actually acquiring a company, so you have some control, but how do you two work with companies to make sure they stay on mission? And is that ever a tough conversation you have to have with somebody? Or is it just the stars always align?
For us, it's pretty simple. You know, this is, bottom line, this is all about two things, really, people and product, mm-hmm. and process kind of comes up behind it. Mm-hmm. But more importantly, if you don't have it in your hand, we're really helpful in mission, vision, values, brand platform. Mm-hmm. We'll sit down with you and take you through that process. We know how to do that, and we'd like to be involved with it and like to help you with it if you need the help.
But what if people see an opportunity to scale, but it's going to require a dilution in some of the values and principles that the company was founded upon? How do you deal with that as an investor?
We can. It depends. Yeah. A lot of it depends on, you know, our investment, mm-hmm. and You know, sometimes we're not the, we're a minority investor, sometimes we're not the largest investor. But I think most of the time you get a pretty good feel for where somebody's headed.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a little bit of gut and a little bit of instinct. And I know that scares some people, but that's a big deal.
I was going to say gut check, even for us as lenders, is really important. We've gone and done a site visit with a company that we had a signed term sheet when we were in underwriting, and we met the management team, and we handed their deposit check right back to them because it just didn't feel right. It goes a long way.
On a side note, we had an opportunity, and it was about a week before we were going to close. And we paid some legal fees out of our own pocket, and we passed. We walked away because it got a little bit weird.
and I hate it when it gets weird.
I got a little jiggy, and with that said, the flag went up, and everybody's gut went up and said, hey, you know what? It's probably best that we don't do this right now.
Yeah. So, and I think gut checks are really important in this space, but I also wonder how much you guys rely on external kind of metrics or values-based standards when you're looking at a company. So there's B Corp, if everybody knows what B Corp does. There's 1% for the planet. I know you guys encourage a lot of your companies to participate. There's GIRS and IRIS ratings, the rate impact. So do you guys look at that? Is a company more interesting to you if they're already involved? What's the value? And do you encourage companies, once they're in your portfolio, to try and push towards B Corp certification or anything like that?
Yeah, happy to take that one. Seventh Generation is a founding B Corp. I think Seventh Generation stumbled around for years in terms of putting some true metrics behind that mission, and how do you balance the people, the planet, the profits, and all those three things to keep the business going forward. So we think the B Corp organization is doing a wonderful job. Clearly, if a company we're talking to is already a B Corp, that gives us a lot of comfort. And you know, early in the days of Seventh Generation, it was all about transforming commerce, enhancing health, building communities, all these things that B Corp do. So we want to have a bigger stakeholder group than just our shareholders. So we want to be good stewards of the communities we live in. We want to make sure we're inspiring a revolution of health and wellness. We want to make sure we're doing the right thing, even if it takes a longer path to get there. Mm-hmm. And there's certainly ways that you can be more expedient in the business. We could launch new products faster that don't meet our standards. We could do a lot of shortcuts, but we're not going to do that because transparency is everything to us. Authenticity is everything to us, and you can't break that trust. You know, our friends at Volkswagen are figuring that out today, probably, right?
Yeah, they might be.
For sure.
That authenticity thing is a really big deal.
It's a big deal.
You know, admittedly, we're probably not as disciplined up front with metrics because everybody we're talking to, they've already stepped up to the table before they talk to us, and that's what we look for.
Yeah, we're very similar. Patagonia is a B Corp and a benefit corporation, so it's very near and dear to our hearts, just like the Blue Angels are.
Every time you talk.
Yeah,
every
I know.
Time
it's
you
awkward.
Talk.
They're trying to throw me off my game. So yeah, it's very important to us. When we look at a company, we don't require them to be a B Corp, but we say, have you done the assessment? If they've done it, we look through it and make sure it's like kind of on the standard that we would expect. Mm-hmm. If they haven't done it, then we encourage them to fill it out, and that helps us in our vetting process. Mm-hmm. And then on the back end, so everything you mentioned, we've looked at those plus others in the whole landscape of impact metrics, because there's thousands out there. Mm-hmm. And what we've done is created our own internal system that kind of picks and chooses what we thought would be the most meaningful. Mm-hmm. So again, we're food, water, energy, waste, and apparel. So we look at things like greenhouse gas emissions that are averted, how many pounds. On the social side, how many jobs are created, how many Native Americans are engaged. And each quarter, I send out a questionnaire to our CEOs. They fill it out, or have somebody on their team fill it out, send it back. And then we have a nice little snapshot of five environmental metrics for the portfolio companies in aggregate and the social metrics. And we place those actually ahead of the financial metrics on where we're tracking and report that out to the Chouinards and the board and our CEO.
Nice. That's awesome. Yeah, at RSF, we have an internal metric system based on five criteria that we think are really that is really important to RSF and our identity and how we want to create change in the world. But we're a founding B Corp, and we also make every single company as part of their term sheet conditions precedent to closing take your B Corp assessment. figure out at least where you score, and then we're going to make you take it every year from now on and see if you get a little bit, if you can bump your score. So it's really important. I'm going to take the liberty as a moderator to give us a few more minutes past the 20 that I promised we cut ourselves off, because I want to ask, and maybe this is just to make it explicit, but to me, we see it as lenders, we see companies that are fairly well established, are probably profitable, have a strong track record. You guys are working with companies that are much, much younger. And we see companies coming to us all the time who have just the wrong cap table. They don't have the right set of investors, not because they're not values aligned, but they're just not the right partners. And so I'm curious, this is a two-part question. What advice would you give to entrepreneurs that have a values-aligned product or a values-driven product that want to grow? And why is it so important that we align, that businesses align their sources of capital with their company and their growth?
You hit the nail on the head. I'll take that one just because it's very near and dear to my heart and very applicable recently. So the cap table is everything. If I go to Rose, our CEO, with the investment list, what we've got in the pipeline, one of the two things we look at is, what's the cap table? Who are their existing investors? Is it a husband and wife team? Is it friends and family? Is it angels? Or are there already some big private equity names that are out there? Mm-hmm. And it really does matter. So to your point, we had a deal we looked at a year ago and wanted to invest in the company. There was a nice supply chain connection. It was husband and wife, majority owned at that point, but there was a private equity that was involved. They had some unique rights and preferences where they could actually block us from coming in and investing, even though, at least in my opinion, we would be a great partner for them to mm-hmm. give them some capital they needed. Mm-hmm. Fast forward a year, that private equity shop tried to take control of the business, and we have since come in. We've been able to structure an investment where we can keep the husband and wife founders as controlling shareholders, because to us that's very important. Mm-hmm. And it's huge, because as an entrepreneur, if you don't take on the right capital, you could lose your business, and that's a really big deal, whether you're mission aligned or not. And so be very selective on who you take in, be very selective on the amount of capital that you take in too. That's huge. If you think you're gonna raise $1 million, can you get by with $500,000? Mm-hmm. Like, I keep going back to the Brio guys, but I love how scrappy they are. They're applying for $5,000 grants, $10,000 grants. Mm-hmm. They're so thrifty with that. And it benefits us, but it also benefits them, because they're the controlling shareholders of the company, and that's how we want to keep it.
Yeah.
You know, the first thing we say to anybody, is, you know, you really shouldn't take money from us. If you can use your debt or revolver, mm-hmm. bank, friend, family, angel, this is the best thing you could ever do, because your life will become more complex when you take money from an outside investor. And it can also become very wonderful if you find the right one, and it can become not so wonderful. As I said in my intro, I can speak from personal experience. On the third flip, I realized that my life and job had changed, mm-hmm. and it wasn't pretty. So with that said, it's not like a divorce. You just can't say, hey, you know, I want to get a divorce. You're in. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're trying to find money to buy them out at the multiple that they need. And it can be pretty ugly. So I'm with you on this one. That cap table and who you align yourself with is incredibly important. We're a small fund, so sometimes people need more, and we partner up with like-minded partners. And so we're very careful about how we pick those partners also.
And I'll look at it from an outside-in perspective. When we're looking at a company who we may want to partner with, we need to absolutely fall in love with the founders, right? Because, as you mentioned, it's you know, you're getting in business for a very long time. You're going to spend a lot of time together. You're going to go to the mat together and make things happen. And you really, really have to get the people piece and that fit right, or else it's going to be problematic for a very long time. And unwinding it is incredibly painful, that's for sure. So I won't rehash a lot of these things these guys said, but I totally agree that, you know, if you don't need to raise capital, don't raise the capital. Ask for advice, ask for help. And then when you're ready to do something, not to be self-serving of people on the stage or, you know, with a certain lens, but just be careful of how you pick your partners, because it is incredibly important, obviously.
Yeah. And I would say that, so it seems like the common piece of advice is be picky about your partners. You don't always, it's hard when you say, I need $1 million to get through the next 6 months. How do I have time to be picky about my partners? But it really matters, even to folks like lenders that are, you know, down the road. It really does matter that you guys figure out how to properly capitalize a company. Because there's good people that are going to want to help you along. But if you don't have the right mix from the beginning, it's going to make it really challenging. So I was going to stop there. We have approximately 13 minutes, and I wanted to give a chance for some Q&A. I don't get to control who gets the microphone. But these two people do.
Question for
you. I'll field that.
Hello? Okay. So we're a B-certified benefit corp and GIRS certified. And I was curious, I don't want you guys to be swamped after this, but this question might do it. How far from your core businesses, like you in clothing, you in food, and you in products like that, are you interested in? You know, we're in media, but we, you know, we do things that are towards your goals, but we're clearly not in your business. So is that something interesting? And hopefully this is of a value to other entrepreneurs so that they can get an idea, should they be talking to you or not? Do you guys understand my question?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. Completely.
Yeah.
I'll take a quick crack at it. It's real simple for us. We need to be able to focus on what we're good at. And, you know, we've decided to focus in consumer packaged goods, and we're focused in the non-food side of it. So, you know, if you make great pizzas, you know, I'll probably turn you over to somebody else or make a connection for you. But if we can continue to leverage our capabilities and understand where our capabilities are, it's going to be better for us all together. So how can I really be helpful to a company that approaches us is a lens that I will look through.
Yep. And so, like I mentioned earlier, we're food, water, energy, waste, and apparel. We prioritize investments in our supply chain because it's mutually beneficial, right? Like in that instance where the company does a liquid CO2-based platform, we can make introductions to our suppliers, they can sell machines, that's where we get the benefit. So in that example, this year we have the potential to save 3.5 million gallons of water through that investment into one little part of our supply chain. So it's a great add that we can contribute in terms of value. That being said, we have made investments. Of the 10, there are two or three that have nothing to do with our supply chain, or very, very, like, you know, it's a stretch if you want to call it that. But the primary lens that we look through is this a business model that benefits the environment in the long term? And you know, we've had 750 applications that have come in, and our funding rate is, you know, you can do the math, it's pretty low. And we do look outside the supply chain as long as it hits our environmental business criteria, but we prioritize the supply chain stuff.
We love building brands. We love brands and we love building brands, and I think we think we're okay at it. At the same time, though, we like to sort of get it in our core competencies. However, I can give you a specific example. We just invested in a small company in the Bay Area, right here in San Francisco, called Fire Clay Tile. To tell you the truth, I don't know jack about tile. However, when we would talk before about people, Eric Edelson, the CEO there, we wish we could clone him. So we jumped into that because we had some people that we knew inside. And also, we felt so strongly about the management team. And the other thing we love is we love new categories. And this guy is a new category, taking custom tile, handmade tile, direct to consumer, and circumventing the retail channel. So with that said, it was just sort of a little, kind of a nice little alignment. We decided to jump in. But so we do stretch out when we need to, when we want to. But media, forget it.
Yeah.
Just kidding.
What is that?
Good one.
Any other questions? There have got to be some.
Here we go, we got it.
Thank you for a great panel. And right before this one, I came from a diversity panel. And with all the work that your larger companies are doing, do you consider diversity in terms of the management team when you're making your investment decisions?
Yeah, we absolutely do. Embrace it. I can't say it's a mathematical computation we make at all, but it's something we struggle with because in one hand, we want to actually specialize in the businesses that I just spoke about to the previous question, and there's a lot of like thinking there, and how do we bring new perspectives to that all the time? And so all the elements of diversity come into play, and I think it makes us stronger, to have different perspectives, different backgrounds. So we would see it as a clear positive for sure.
Yeah, and we're the same way. So again, like environmental impact, but in terms of diversity, women-owned businesses, we also prioritize First Nation investments. So communities that have been impoverished, can we make an investment that benefits a First Nation tribe as well? So we look at all those things. You know, we have the environmental ethos of the fund, but through that, I mean, it's hand in glove with the social side too and diversity. And we track it. So to me, if you track it, it's something that you care about.
Mm-hmm. I'd answer yes, but we're probably not as metriced as we need to be. Two examples would be we just invested in BioLite, a small little wood burning stove that is doing wonderful work in emerging markets. And I just got back from San Diego with The Honest Kitchen, which is a pet food company, 10-pound box of dehydrated human grade food instead of a 40-pound bag of kibble, which you should not feed your dog. But anyway, we did an innovation day with them, and out of the 12 people there, 8 were women. This was super cool. Yeah. That was great.
RSF also, we lend to companies a similar size that these guys invest in. So we actually, we have 1,700 investors at RSF, and I believe 60%, I'm looking at Melinda, our Director of Communications and Marketing, 60% of those people invested in RSF that want to align their money with their values are women. There's an incredible movement. It is a good time to be a woman in business, and RSF is actually right now raising an internal fund to support women in leadership and women in business. So it's important. Yeah. Any other questions?
One back there.
So you all have talked about the importance of the cap table mix. I'm interested for, since this is sort of the context of sort of corporate venture, corporate M&A activity, do you all have philosophies or hypotheses or experience where you've looked at a deal and there's been an ostensible competitor on the other side of the cap table and you've kind of walked away for sort of competitive reasons? And I guess I would just contextualize thinking about sort of the broader compact of impact investing where is there like a pre-competitive space where the business and the kind of social value of your kind of respective strategies could align? Or is that something y'all have just given any thought to? Thanks.
We look at it so we do outdoor apparel and then food as well. So we look at it as, is there another big food company that's invested? If so, like, how is that going to work? Because oftentimes, what we do with our fund is try and unlock an environmental innovation, so a disruptive technology or eco-innovation, and then we want to be first to market with it, which could, to your question, pose some problems if the other investors are competitors. Right after we're first to market, though, our model is to open it up to everybody, because that's, if we invest in a company that has a kick-ass environmental innovation, they release it, it scales, and as an investor, we benefit in that. And then we're first to market as well, and it's something that just is a brand, you know, builds your brand as well. So for us, we definitely consider it. We haven't run into too many instances where we haven't done a deal because of that, but again, we closely examine the cap table for that very reason.
Our perspective is it's a field of dreams, right? So if we can build it, you know, the consumers are coming this way. We all know that. If I had a birthday party when I turned 10, my mom would have bought, you know, Doritos and Coke, right? And if somebody does that today for their 10-year-old, you know, the rest of the moms will be, you know, incredibly upset about how could you do that to my kid. So in one generation, the world has changed. And so we're going to continue to lean in together. So we're cheerleaders for anyone who's doing a similar thing we do. So our competitors are really the companies that that ruled the last 100 years, and I never see them invested in anything we're looking at. So companies that are somewhat in our space, I'm happy to line up and fight with together.
We actually just closed on investment in Doritos and Coke. Is that bad?
I probably shouldn't mention them.
I had some Doritos before I got up, and I'm just craving for more right now.
We've never
had a cap table. We've said no because of a complexity to a cap table. Up to this point, in 5 years, we've never said no to sort of a competitive threat on a cap table. So it really hasn't happened to us, so I'm probably not qualified to talk about it.
We have time for one more question.
There it is. Oh, there it is. Again.
Two. You guys are boring.
Who will it be? Yeah, really.
So it sounds like you have adequate deal flow inbound because of the position you're holding and the value of what you're able to provide as an investor. Do you consider or do any activities that are kind of outbound seeking particular, you have your areas of focus, but do you ever do any activities, maybe issue RFPs or look for deal flow outbound?
Yeah, wow, RFP, that just scares the heck out of me.
You haven't heard that since your first job.
Oh, my God.
14 years,
you know,
2 months.
Even as a consultant, I would refuse to fill out RFPs. Because I'm a one-person shop by design. I would never do that. But to your point, our outbound is more about, is all about our network. It's all about trade shows. It's all about conferences like this. Mm-hmm. It's all about like-minded individuals that we find by just being outbound. That's kind of our MO, and technically it's always best to find us. If you're, you know, I mean, it's sort of tongue-in-cheek, but if you're filling out the contact page on our website, it's not really the way to meet us. Mm-hmm. The way to meet us is face-to-face. We really like that with that type of contact.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
He agrees.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Now, we're the same way. So we've had 750 applications that have come in. A couple of those we've actually resulted in an investment and funded the company, but we prefer the ones where we have relationships. So Kate gives me a call and say, hey, we're looking at providing debt capital. These guys, do you want to come in on the equity side and the capital stack? And those are the deals that we're more likely to invest in. Mm-hmm. And then we also try and be strategic because you don't want to just sit around and be a taker of everything that comes in. We want to say, hey, there's a huge need in waterless dyeing in the outdoor apparel supply chain or whatever the problem of the day is. And then we say, okay, who's doing it? Who's best in class? Is this a type of company that we can invest in? Like, mm-hmm. are they already $500 million or are they small in our, you know, $1 to $20 million sweet spot? Mm-hmm. And those are the ones where we've had the most success pulling things through, and they're going to be our best investments.
Real quick, specific example. I run to the bathroom last minute. I run into Trip Baird, who's a super smart investment dude who I love, and mm-hmm. he tells me about something right out in front. Hey, by the way, and so most of the time, that type of connective capital is where we find it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I totally agree. It's all about networking, connections. We do outbound 99.5%. We look at companies that we think would be appropriate, good mission fit, great people running them. I pick up the phone and I call people, maybe reach out through LinkedIn. We have had no luck with inbound, and generally those are troubled companies, what I've found, in terms of, hey, we have, you know, $5 million in sales and we're only losing $1 million a year and we have 5,000 SKUs and all these issues. And it's like, wow, you know, we can't bury ourselves by doing, you know, 20 fix-it deals. And so we may have some bandwidth to do some of that, but we really want to enhance businesses that are getting some traction. And again, it's all about the people first and, you know, is this something we can build upon?
Yeah. And I'm going to take the last word on that, because at RSF, we get a tremendous amount of inbound and we take all of it. But we've actually, as over the years, we've gotten a lot more clarity about the type of change we want to see in each of our focus areas. We've become experts in our focus areas, and we build networks and we build relationships with people that keep us top of mind so that, yeah, I get a call from Phil, I get a call from Kate Story at Renewal Funds, and I will always look at what they send me, because I've spent a lot of time with those folks talking about what we do, and if And if they know what we're doing, we're going to look at it. We partner an awful lot with folks. And I guess the one piece of advice, when you guys were giving your pieces of advice about what would you say to an entrepreneur, from my perspective, on the debt side and watching companies grow and build their capital stack, is start now. This is a relationship-based business. The average, I think for RSF, at least in food and ag, it takes approximately 2.5 to 3 years of knowing us from your first conversation to when we actually will lend you money.
Good point.
And that is that's excellent. A long time. So start now. Shake hands, meet people. You probably are not going to be a fit for them right now, but in 2 or 3 years, you just never know. And you never know who you're going to run into on the way to the bathroom that's going to say, hey, I have a deal for you. I saw Trip in that conversation. I was like, Trip, I've got a deal for you, while he was probably pitching you another deal. So this is that's how it works. So,
and I should just add, we get a lot of inbound too.
Yeah.
And most of it may not fit, but we always reach back out, talk to people, say, hey, thanks, but no thanks. Mm-hmm. And hey, why don't you talk to my friend here? Or so we always try and help out because we think that those are good deeds that need to be done.
Yeah. Cool. Thank you. You guys, thanks so much for bearing with us until 5 o'clock. Appreciate it.